You know, it's interesting that you're mentioning that now, because one of the most useful things that I found was very prominent on your website, and that is you have pages and pages of items for women to do, to watch out for, to be careful about.
Yes.
That would comprise a plan.
Yes.
So I hope that we will put up the URL for your website. There it is. This website is useful also for book orders. We're going to be talking about the book in a few minutes, and this will give you access to the place where you can place orders.
Yes.
For the book, the Blood and Tears of Domestic Violence.
Yes.
What would you say is the most important thing for a woman to do if she sees herself in that situation?
Seek help. There's agencies that are here that will help you and that will listen to you, and they are knowledgeable about what you're supposed to do to escape. And it's very, very serious, because there's so many murders going on. It's mind-boggling how many murders are going on behind domestic violence. And if they have the proper help and guidance, they can get out of the situation. But the unique thing with me is that I say not just the victim, the abuser needs help, because if he is still abusing, he's going to go on to his next victim.
So could you talk a little bit about what you mean by the abuser needs help? What
yes.
would that mean in terms of public policy?
Yes, there are the abuser programs that are there for help. A lot of them are court ordered, and what I find is that makes the abuser even angrier when they're court ordered for what's called anger management classes or abuser help. But what I would think is that a 24-hour abuser hotline publicized just like the victim's hotline would be
a whole separate
but publicized just as much. I think that it would be a help, even if it saved just one life, because what they need is volunteer help. They don't need to be pushed into it by the court system, because many times that makes them angrier. And so many victims are killed, and they have order of protections in their hands. So with the court interceding, that means that that abuser is going to be so much angrier at the victim. But I think if they can reach out for help and know that help is available, and we have so much technology through email,
right,
chat
right.
rooms, everything, I think that something should be put in place 24 hours a day for them to be able to access it, just like the victim's hotlines.
But I can see where the victims have an incentive to call their hotlines because they want to get out of it.
Mm-hmm.
But what incentive, if it's not the court, what incentive does the abuser have to make that call?
Because he knows he has a problem. It's not that they don't know that what they're doing is wrong. And what I did find I'll go into that when I have to tell about the friend that I was talking about earlier. But what it is they need someone to talk to, because if they have someone that can guide them in the right way and let them know that there's other options besides violence and even down to murder, I think that they would go for it. And even if it saves one life, I think that it would help.
Yeah. What happens now? Let's say that the police come and they're confronted with a domestic violence situation. I remember in the old days that the woman could say, I'm not pressing charges. Is
yes.
that still true?
Or? In some cases, the police officers don't react the way they are supposed to. And that comes with a few reasons. We have police officers that also are abusers, and they would side with the abuser. Mm-hmm. And I can just tell you about my own experience with that. I was beat up one time really bad. The police officers arrived at the home, and one took me into the kitchen, and he told me, if you would have treated your husband better, this wouldn't happen to you. And then he went into the living room, and he told him, I'm going to make sure nothing happens to you.
Mm.
So it's all about who responds.
What hope was there
exactly.
for you? Yeah. I want to talk a little bit about the book, because that's really why we're here. It's your 10-year effort, as I understand it.
Yes.
To tell your story.
Yes.
Encouraged by your divorce attorney,
yes.
you told me. And at some point, you finished that book after you had been putting it aside and putting it aside, and at some point you finished the book.
Yes.
Did something help you to finish the book?
Yes.
You know, make you decide this is it?
Yes. At the urging of my divorce attorney, she had me to write a 3-page synopsis about some of the incidents of abuse. And when I finished writing it, she asked me, could she read it before her group of about 1,000 women? And she called me and said, Donna, I've never seen that reaction before. She said, nearly every woman was crying in the audience.
Wow.
And she said, they wanted to know, were you still alive? So I said, well, wow, and I was amazed. And then she said, I want you to write a book. So
there's the book on the screen right now. Yeah?
Yes, and I started writing the book. And then I kept putting it down because when I would try and transcribe it, my computer kept crashing. And then I didn't know how to end the book. So I just said, oh, well. And then in May of 2006, my current husband, who is nonviolent, he had a friend and a coworker that was having problems with his wife. And he had been coming over to our house and he had been telling us about the wife and problems. And he was looking for a gun at that point. Yes, and we were just wondering, why is he looking for a gun? But then I heard in my spirit that he was going to kill his wife, so I told my husband about it, and then, what was it, 4 days later, he killed his wife and her mother and himself. Yeah, and that was when I was living in Woodbridge, New Jersey, and at that point, that's when I knew that I had to finish my book. And I didn't know what help it would be, but the positive feedback that I'm getting from so many victims is showing me that it was the right thing for me to do. And I'm really on a mission and passion to go out there and make a difference because of the murder rate that's going on with domestic violence.
And because you had been saved
yes.
from that, you must have really hit you hard.
Yes.
We have very little time left, and I just want to know, is there something else that you want us to know? Because I know you're going around to colleges
yes.
and high schools and available through your website
yes.
To speak.
Yes.
And it seems to me that your message is so important. I mean, I look at the dating situation with dating violence
yes.
and with students who don't even know that there's anything wrong with it.
Yes.
So it's happening at a younger and younger age.
Yes.
Is there anything else that you want to tell us before we have to close up?
Sure. Yes, it's very important what I'm doing, and I will be going to all of the colleges, high schools, and I'm starting in New York and New Jersey because this is where I'm located, but I will be traveling abroad from here. I'm going to churches to speak about it because so many people need to be aware of what's going on, and we need to look at who's around us and what they're going through so that we can be of help as a community and so that we can lower the murder rate that's going on behind domestic right. violence.
And your website again is dmsavage.com.
Yes.
Thank you so much. This
You're
was
welcome.
If you have that passion, as I know you have, to
yes.
make a difference, I'm sure that through this show and through your speaking and writing, you will and
yes.
have made a difference.
Thank you so much.
I appreciate it. Very good.